Good morning, Osborne Church family. Pastor Andrew Abbott here, ready to dive into another sermon with you all via video as we look at Luke chapter 21. I'm going to encourage you to have your Bibles all ready to dive in together into this chapter. But first off, let's have a word of prayer. Let's bow our heads. Dear Jesus, thank you for the opportunity of diving into this chapter together. Give us open minds and willing hearts to apply what we learn from your word, and thank you for your love. In Jesus' name, amen. Have you ever stared with your own eyes into the bowels of an active volcano? I can't say that I have personally, but many people, tourists, who have scoured the globe looking for these volcanic sites have had that privilege. If you go to a place like Kilauea in Hawaii, Etna in Italy, Bâton de la Française in France, you can see these majestically fierce craters full of volcanic magma. There's a whole world of pressurized lava swirling beneath our feet under the Earth's crust, the mantle. And there's a whole world of fierce power locked in there as well. The surface of the earth can look solid and peaceful when you take a gander at it on the surface, but just beneath that is a tremendous amount of power. And that power was fully on display when Matt and Lauren Urey saw this plume of ash arching above them, coloring the blue sky with gray as they strode through White Island in New Zealand. They were newlyweds who were on a honeymoon there. They were all primed for adventure. They wanted a fun time. But this fun adventure was quickly turning into a nightmare. The active volcano blasted this huge plume of ash and debris and rock and lava, and they realized that the next few seconds were going to be critical. Instead of running for dear life like everyone else, they opted to hunker down behind a pile of rubble to protect themselves from the onslaught of debris. Thankfully, the local authorities had given them respirators just in case. They quickly put those over their mouths so they wouldn't suffocate from the poisonous gas that was spewing out. And the barricade that they found did stop the onslaught of debris and protect them in the meantime. And once the dust settled, a rescue chopper whizzed in there, whisked them away to the nearest hospital where they received treatment. They were just covered in these severe burns from the heat and the ash, but they had survived. They had survived, in fact, probably what was one of the worst volcanic disasters in the last decade. But others, unfortunately, were not so fortunate. Several tourists lost their lives that day in the volcano. And the eruption shows the fiery power that lies beneath the volcano can't be trifled with. The signs of the impending eruption were all around them at that point. In fact, several months before, authorities and scientists and researchers had noted the building and building and building of the volcanic power. They had cameras posted, they had seismographs, they had microphones all monitoring this mountain. And just a couple weeks before the eruption, an earthquake had shaken White Island and the mainland of New Zealand. The researchers agreed that the alert level of the volcano was at number 2, but the touring agency knew that people had booked a voyage. They knew tourists were expecting them to make good on their promise to take them to White Island and give them the adventure of a lifetime in the tropics. And so they thought they could manage to monitor the volcano and ferry tourists to this island at the same time. But on that morning on December 9, their lack of attention to the signs proved disastrous. the signs of the times had gone unheeded. As we look at the world around us today, the escalating fury of a volcano could be a good analogy of the crises and concerns we see around us. Just in the last couple months, we've seen military threats against our country. We've seen fires decimate the forests of Australia. We've seen a synagogue attacked, families suffering in war zones. Our world is groaning, my friends. But we as Christians can see and know that these groans are not just brief crises. They are, in fact, the making of a climax on the horizon. They are, in fact, signs that Jesus is coming soon to take his people home. Can I share a Bible promise with you? Let's go in the scriptures. Please turn with me to Luke chapter 21, verses 25 through 28. Luke chapter 21, verses 25 through 28. Here it is. There will be signs in the sun, moon, and stars. On earth, nations will be in anguish and perplexity at the roaring and tossing of the sea. People will faint from terror, apprehensive of what is coming on the world. For the heavenly bodies will be shaken. At that time, they will see the Son of Man coming in a cloud with great power and great glory. When these things begin to take place, stand up and lift up your heads, because your redemption draws nigh. The text makes it clear. These crises and these perplexities that are surrounding us right now, that feel like they're about to erupt into a huge disaster, dangers of each kind, they're signs that we can lift up our heads, look to the sky, so to speak, knowing that our deliverance in the form of Christ appearing is very near. We can confidently look to his coming as the solution, even though the world around us seems to be breaking. When, for instance, a strain of antibiotic-resistant bacteria suddenly sends a panic across the world, we can look to Christ coming as the ultimate healer. When a spat of war footage flashes across our TV screens, we can look to him as the ultimate coming peacemaker. When photos of fresh wreckage pepper our inbox after an earthquake, we can look to him as the coming creator, the ultimate creator. When we hear about another awful famine in the deserts of Africa, we can look to the coming of the ultimate provider. Christ's coming was the blessed hope that stirred the hearts of our Adventist pioneers as well, and it's still our blessed hope today. In fact, when this fledgling church came together back in 1860 to decide on a name, back in Battle Creek, Michigan, the leaders all settled on the name Seventh-day Adventist. Emphasis on Advent. Adventist. We are about the second Advent. That's what will occupy our minds until the world is over. It's ingrained. It's part of our history, our very DNA. But even though this hope stirs our hearts, and we know that it's our destiny as long as we cling to Christ, we still can't deny that this, during the waiting time in between, we feel a very real sense of vulnerability. I'm reminded of a story not too long ago that I read from a preacher, a well-known preacher named Francis Shan, well-known gospel preacher. And in one of his books, he mentioned this instance where he was, it's a very memorable moment, handing his newborn son, Zeke, to his little baby sister for the very first time. She was so eager to hold her little baby brother, just a few weeks old, that she had reached out her hands eagerly with her eyes glowing. And Pastor Francis Shan, he had his dear little fragile baby son in his arms. He looked at his daughter, They made eye contact, and he said, "Okay, her name was Mercy, by the way. Okay, Mercy, I'm going to hand over your little baby brother. But first, I want you to remember and keep this in mind that he has just been born. He's only a few weeks old, and he is very, very fragile. Be very careful with your little baby brother." But after he said that, it suddenly dawned on him. He's fragile because he's a little guy, but honestly, will there ever be a time in his life when he isn't fragile? Fragile newborn baby, fragile toddler, fragile child, fragile adolescent, fragile adult. There are many things that will still threaten. I'm going to pause at this point and just pose a question to you all just to foster discussion. Here it is. What kind of images or pictures or descriptive words come to mind when you hear the term vulnerable? Go ahead, pause the video and just talk that over in your group there for a few minutes. Life is precious, fragile, easily breakable, no matter what age. There's so many possible threats, diseases, injuries, accidents, despair, disillusionment, so many things that could threaten his little son. And would there ever be a time where he could say he's beyond danger? We all struggle with that, friends. We all struggle with the reality that we're fragile human beings in a hostile world. And we're stuck in the midst of a tenuous waiting game. Even though we know from Scripture the end of the story. And I'm sure as we start looking at the bigger picture here in the chapter, in chapter 24, 21 in Luke, that the woman at the beginning of this chapter also felt that deep uneasiness, that vulnerability. The chapter starts off with the story of a poor widow who was offering up the very last two coins she had in her purse as a temple offering. She's tossing in all the resources she's got. Everything she owns is right there in the offering plate being taken away. And Jesus greets this sight by saying to his disciples, "This poor widow has put in more than all the others. All these people gave their gifts out of their wealth, but she, out of her poverty, put in all that she had to live on." This widow definitely presents a picture of vulnerability. She's at the end of her rope. She's laying everything on the altar there. Nothing's left for support or feeding herself or her family. And yet, Jesus points to the rest of the chapter to reveal the underlying problem, the biggest problem, in fact, that lies at the heart of her situation and many others. And that is injustice. In fact, injustice plays a large role in the rest of this chapter, but also beyond that in the New Testament and throughout much of the Old Testament as well. But let's look at Luke 21. It says in verses 12 through 19, these are Jesus' words speaking of the last days. "But before all this, they will seize you and persecute you. They will hand you over to synagogues and put you in prison, and you'll be brought before kings and governors, all on account of my name. And so you will bear testimony to me. But make up your mind not to worry beforehand how you will defend yourselves, for I will give you the words and wisdom that none of your adversaries will be able to resist or contradict. You will be betrayed even by parents, brothers and sisters, relatives, friends, and some of you will be put to death. Everyone will hate you because of me, but not a hair of your head will perish. Stand firm, and you will win life." Those who follow Christ will expect dangers and heartaches, partly because their faithfulness to God will be seen as a slight to the human authorities that are demanding their first allegiance. And they'll be brought to a crossroads. Are we going to serve humans or are we going to serve God? And even though they're putting God first, they're making the moral choice, they're being faithful to God's character and following what is the true good and helping others, they'll still end up being punished. It's injustice. And not only that, but God's concern over injustice is a big theme in the Old Testament as well. Deuteronomy, these words of Moses, 24, verse 17, "You shall not pervert the justice due to the sojourner and the fatherless, or take a widow's garment in pledge, but you shall remember that you were a slave in Egypt, and the Lord your God redeemed you from there. Therefore, I command you to do this." But the higher classes of Israel did start straying more and more into oppression, as the Old Testament prophets show. Isaiah points out Judah's greed when he says, "Surely the arm of the Lord is not too short to save, nor his ear too dull to hear, but your iniquities have separated you from your God. Your sins have hidden his face from you so that you will not hear, for your hands are stained with blood, your fingers with guilt. Your lips have spoken falsely, and your tongue mutters wicked things." And he sums it up by saying, "So justice is far from us, and righteousness does not reach us. We look for light, but all is darkness; for brightness, but we walk in deep shadows." That's Isaiah 59, where Isaiah is just pouring out his heart. This is what I see. Injustice is all around us, and God can't bless us as a result. Jeremiah likens the rich and powerful of his day who are oppressing the poor as those who do not promote the case of the fatherless, and they do not defend the cause of the poor. That's a quote from Jeremiah chapter 5, verses 27 through 28. And there are many other messages from the prophets where they're emphasizing that God is about fairness. His character is about defending rather than exploiting. And these prophets, they saw what they called the day of the Lord as the great reckoning day, as the great day when the Messiah would come, when he would bring judgment and set things straight and bring down those oppressive systems and bring justice and peace. And we also look for the day of the Lord, the second coming day of the Lord, when Christ will come and finally restore the persecuted and judge the oppressors. That day is coming. But at the same time, this theme of justice doesn't just point to deliverance, but also points to the fact that we all, honestly, folks, we all, because we're sinners, deserve punishment. It's what Romans 6, verse 23 says, "For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord." And honestly, because we're sinners, we're all in the same boat. We all need forgiveness from God for our selfish actions, our ugly thoughts, our harsh words, or even the kind deeds to others that we've left undone. And realizing our levelness, our equality, that we're all in the same situation before God, before Christ, as our gracious Savior, we look to Him as our great forgiver and deliverer. And realizing that gives us a new perspective on how we can relate to each other. Being a National Geographic photographer is definitely an adventurous task. The photographer that I was listening to on the radio definitely had his share of adventures. He was telling about them, how he had handled exotic predators in the studio. He had hiked across these unforgiving deserts in the middle of nowhere. He had caught a deadly disease as he was trekking through the jungle. His life could definitely be described as hair-raising. But the story that really touched me wasn't about his death-defying feats. It was about the intimacy that he experienced in looking through a camera lens at the exquisite detail of rare creatures in a studio setting. His big project, the big project he was most proud of, was called the Photo Ark, where he had gathered all these creatures that were endangered, possibly going extinct, and he had brought them into a studio setting. Sometimes it was just a makeshift little hut that he set up in the wilderness. But he got his camera out, he got the lighting he needed, and he would snap a photo at that perfect moment. All right, we're going to pause here for another question just to get into this a little deeper. Ponder this. How would you feel if you experienced meeting a Sumatran rhino, a huge burly creature like that, in the confines of a photography studio? What would that feel like? Just talk it over with your friends there for a little bit. And he realized that seeing each creature through the lens of his camera gave him a different perspective. When they're in the studio in that hut or whatever he had available, with the lights on, with his camera zoomed in, everything that separated those animals as far as size seemed to disappear. Whether it was a huge Sumatran rhino or a tiny praying mantis, each creature filled the frame and seemed larger than life. Each creature was shown in all its exquisite detail, and he called this detailed individual view the great equalizer. Every one of them was brought into sharp focus as a precious work of art. And we can take that same principle to heart too, my friends, as Christians looking for Christ's second coming. Not in the very same situation of seeing a creature through a camera lens, but instead looking through our own lens of realizing our need of Christ's grace and his soon coming. That kind of perspective will lead us to see how we're all brothers and sisters on equal footing in front of Jesus' great sacrifice. No one is better than anyone else. We stand as one with our hearts beating and our heads lifted, as Luke 21 says, because we're all sinners saved by grace. And no one can claim to be elevated by status or entitlement above anyone else, regardless of their past or what they've done or their background. We are all together as a community of grace, looking for Jesus' soon coming. They had all, each one, heard the promise of deliverance from the captain's own lips. They had grown very attached to this man they called Sir, this captain that had been leading them all this time. And now they're about to stake their future on his promise of rescue. And they had trust in him. He had faithfully led them for the past year and a half. They had seen him sweat over dangerous odds. They had seen him make split-second decisions. And they had actually heard with their own ears his orders that every man would have equal duties on the ship. And all this had played out as they had seen their ship stranded, the vessel crushed to smithereens. They had seen their comrades and themselves hiking for endless days over shifting ice floes, and finally settled on a barren wasteland in the middle of the Antarctic Ocean. It was called Elephant Island. And up to that point, none of the crew had been lost. They had all survived as far as they had made it, but they're definitely far from being rescued. They knew no one was going to find them here. This was an uninhabited speck of land in the middle of the ocean, and the nearest human settlement was a whaling station on South Georgia, over 720 nautical miles north of them. 720 of the roughest, most hostile, barren stretch of ocean in the world. And the only vessel they had was a tiny lifeboat called the James Caird that they had salvaged from their larger ship Endurance. And their leader, Ernest Shackleton, was declaring right now that he and a few other crew members were going to take the risk and try to reach it as quickly as possible. That South Georgia Island was their last hope. But there were dozens of things that could go wrong. There was the wind that could topple their ship, there were hurricane gale force gales that might sweep in and decimate their little lifeboat. They could, if they made just a tiny little error by a few degrees charting their path, they could totally miss the island and get swept hopelessly out to sea, there were dozens of hang-ups and risks, and everyone knew that their only hope of rescue hung on this one little ship, on this one mission. Because of that, they knew the odds, they knew the risks. Their departure was almost unbearable. They were now waiting breathlessly to see if their trust in Shackleton would be fulfilled. And at this point, 4 months had passed. They were all just trying to make it through each day without going mad. The barrenness, the coal spray, the wind, the same tasteless seal blubber that they had at each meal, it was all just too much. And they realized it had been more than enough time for Shackleton to make it there and back. Every single day that went by seemed to shout louder and louder that their situation was hopeless. There was nothing they could do. But as they settled into their meal that morning of tasteless seal blubber, they all gathered around their little fire for whatever warmth they could eke out of this hut they had constructed out of driftwood. And it was plain to see this was going to be like any other day. But then they heard a voice. They looked up to see one of their comrades stick his head into the hut. He opened his eyes wide, looked around the group, shrugged his shoulders, and said, "Shouldn't we send up a smoke signal?" For a moment, they all paused, wondering in their heads, what's going on? What's this guy talking about? And then it dawned on them what he was saying. They leaped to their feet. They smashed through the walls of that driftwood hut. They started frenzied excitement, running up to the top of the hill. They crested the hill. They looked around, scanned, and there it was, a little lifeboat coming towards them from the larger mother ship. He had come back. There was total pandemonium on that hill. They were all giggling like schoolgirls. One of the guys gathered a huge hunk of grass, plopped it down. They sent up a smoke signal. They lit it, and then another guy got a piece of driftwood, took his shirt off, and strung it up to wave in the boat. The captain had made it. He had fulfilled his promise. He hadn't let them down after all. And friends, as we look around at the world today, things can seem bleak. Things can seem very much crisis-ridden and tough to deal with. It may even seem a little bit like being on that forgotten island in the midst of the Antarctic Ocean, just wondering, when is our captain going to come and rescue us? But let's not forget the heartfelt promise that Jesus has left us. I'm going to read it here in your hearing. This is John 14, verses 1 through 3. Please read along with me. John 14, 1 through 3. Jesus says, "Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also." Let's keep our eyes on the skies, so to speak, and realize that in pressing together and leaning on each other and keeping our gaze on our captain who will split open those clouds someday soon, we can trust that he will make good on his promise. God bless.